Ben, here we are in our final film of the series on the Virgin Mary. And in this film, we're going to focus on the Virgin as Ecclesia, or as Church, and also as Intercessor. And the first work we're looking at here in the Gemäldegalerie is this exquisite small panel by the painter Jan van Eyck, which he paints in the 1440s. And as you can see, the Virgin and Child here are standing in a Gothic church, but immediately you'll notice that their proportions are monumental. So the Virgin's height is beyond that of the architecture there, and they kind of fill that central space. And I think one of the other distinctive things about this composition is the way the light is treated, and van Eyck is known for his painting of light. And it immediately draws your eyes to the way the light is filtering through this upper clerestory level in the Gothic church and pooling on the nave floor in a really beautiful way. If you're familiar with this kind of architecture, you'll know that these churches were oriented to the east. So we're looking to the east into the sanctuary towards the altar in this church. And traditionally, the light then would filter in through either the east or the south. And immediately here, then you notice that the light is coming in from the north, which never would have happened. And then you should become aware that this is some sort of otherworldly, sacred light. And then you might start thinking about those windows in a new way. And I think van Eyck is deliberately referring to a medieval tradition, which then continued on through the Renaissance and into the Baroque, of describing the Virgin as a window. She's known as a fenestra cieli, a window to heaven, or even a fenestra cristallina, crystalline window. And the metaphor here is associating the way the light is able to penetrate the window and leave it unbroken with the Virgin Mary. She is able to give birth to the Christ child whilst remaining intact and remaining a virgin.
And light is such a powerful image in New Testament texts about the church. So for example, in the letter to the Ephesians, Christians are described as once having dwelt in darkness and now being children of light. And Mary, in a sense, is the quintessential Christian, and in some ways also represents the church itself. So she sort of embodies the soul, the heart and soul of the church. And here she's identified with its architecture, but the architecture itself is a sort of metaphor for the church's reality, which is it's a community of people. And that community is, like Mary herself, a place of nurture. Christians talk about how they have a sort of new birth in the church. Baptism is a kind of new birth. And so, like Mary's womb, the church itself is a place in which people come to new life and then are brought up in that new life. And each individual Christian is also, in a way, like Mary, receiving the word of God, hearing it in this case, as she heard the message of the angel, and then nurturing that word within themselves so that it can grow and flourish. So she represents the church as a whole and each individual Christian. And churches are places where people pray. And intercession is a particular kind of prayer where the needs and desires and longings of the people of God are offered up to God in prayer, the petitions, the requests. And Mary also is a quintessential example of how to pray in that way. And we're going to look at an example of her doing that in our final object in the Bode-Museum.
Ben, we've been thinking a lot about the Virgin in relation to architecture. And I wanted to show you these two panels here in the Bode-Museum. They come from a very early 13th century monastic complex in Constantinople, present-day Istanbul. As you can see, this panel represents the Virgin Mary, and she's making a very striking gesture, raising her hands like this. And as you can see, she's also accompanied by the Archangel Michael. These objects originally were affixed to pillars, and they were mounted on what's called a bema in Greek, which is a kind of raised platform. So this is a space that separates the main nave of a church with an upper raised space. That's a space that's only accessible to members of the clergy, primarily. And so they are helping to designate a more sacred space within the church, which I think also associates her with architecture, not least because she's also represented as standing on a little kind of bema pedestal herself. In the Orthodox tradition, these would be described as icons, which are distinct from sacred images in the West, More often, icons are understood as mediating presences. So not only do they represent a sacred figure, but there's an understanding that that sacred figure is somehow present and that the object itself acts as a kind of portal between this earthly world and the heavenly paradise beyond.
The fact that she's raising her hands in what's called the Orans position, which means the praying position, is also, I think, suggestive of a portal between heaven and earth, because prayer itself is, if you like, an offering across that threshold between earth and heaven. And to see Mary like this as someone who prays, almost sort of quintessentially someone who prays, is to be reminded of her history as it's narrated in the biblical narratives, the fact that she intercedes with her son even when he's on earth. And although, as we noted in one of our earlier films, they sometimes have some slightly apparently fractious exchanges, she also does influence him. And that power of prayer is associated with Mary all the way through her life. And the last mention of her in Scripture is in the book of Acts, which tells the story of the church as it develops after Jesus' death and resurrection and ascension. And she's described as being in the midst of the disciples praying. So to meet her here praying is a wonderful way to be reminded of that power of prayer that she has, and also of how her story in biblical terms ends. As we look at this image of the Virgin right at the end of our series of films, the final object that we're looking at, I'm reminded of where we began in our introductory film, and that similarly full frontal sculpture of the Virgin as the seat of wisdom, the throne of wisdom. And in that, she was presenting the Christ child quite forcibly to us. But here in this image, with her son now ascended into heaven, there's a sense of closure, of completion, because now instead of offering him, presenting him to us, she is commending us to him, commending us to his protection, calling down his grace on us. And it's nice to think of her being here, engaged in that act of prayer. Whether or not anyone's here to see her, she remains architecturally solid, permanent, standing here in her own right and here for us to come and rediscover every time we visit the museum, continuing her ministry of intercession.